Okay, good afternoon, everybody. We are going to get started with the Turing 100 session, lecture series. Quick overview, so why we have been doing this. So we have been arranging lectures for almost, this is the seventh lecture. Again, the goal over here is to celebrate the life and work of Alan Turing, who is the father of computer science, and we are in his centennial year. Why we are doing this, again, Alan Turing was highly influential in computer science. He sort of formalized the concepts of algorithm and computation. But even though he has done such a monumental piece of work, he is not that famous, or not many people know about his work and his sort of contribution. So the whole idea of this session is to celebrate his work, as well as get people to know about what all the work he has done. About today's event, we're going to have a lecture on Life and Work of Ivan Sutherland, and it's going to be given by Mr. Atul Nathkade. And after that, we'll have a short tea break. And followed by that, we'll have a lecture on Evolution of Modern Graphics Architecture, the focus on GPUs. This is going to be given by Sanjeev Sarkar from India. This session is going to be easily right at Nagpur, Hyderabad, Goa, and also at KK Wark College, Nasik. So if any of you have questions in the lecture, would request you to hold them on and ask them at the end. We'll ask out for questions at the end of the lecture. Turing lecture series, first Saturday of every month. We have some speakers who agreed to give till June 2013. That will be exactly 1 year since we started. So we definitely want to have till June 2013, and we are still undecided whether we will follow it up and keep continuing, because we still have a lot of Turing award winners to talk about. We'll see how to take it forward. So today we will talk about, again, life and work of Ivan Sutherland. On May 11, Panduran Kamath is going to be talking about the RSA trio, essentially their contributions of making public key cryptography useful in practice. That's going to be on May 11, 2013. We're still formalizing date for talking about contributions of Barbara Liskov, and it's going to be given by Jay Deshpande. And then Fran Allen, again, this is something which people have agreed to, it's by Hemant Pandey is going to talk about her contributions. And then again, Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie, which is going to talk about it. Again, we are still formalizing the dates for all these lectures. Again, you can go to amturing.acm.org. It's an excellent website. All the Turing Award winners, their lectures, their papers, their contributions are all available over there. We highly recommend that for visiting the website. Okay, when we have been having various events, so also as part of this Turing Centennial at Persistent, we had a semicolons programming contest in August. We had a technology showcase in October. We had a Turing run in December, and then a Turing quiz last time around, where a lot of, this is a different one, this is a CSI Turing quiz. And again, the best place to keep track of all the events which we are organizing as part of the Centennial is the website. Again, it's available. You can also email us at turing100@persistent.org. Again, a quick plug for ACM. Highly recommend that all of you join and be a member of ACM. We have ACM India chapter as well, and this is quite active over here as well. About today's speaker, so first we're going to talk about the contributions of life and work of Ivan Sutherland, so it's run by Atul Nathkade. So I'm just going to give a quick overview, quick background of Atul. Atul is CTO of GS Labs and leads the technology strategy and roadmap for the entire for the early stage product development services company. He is also a co-founder and CTO of Keypoint, a technology spin-off from GS Labs in the interactive searchable video space. He grapples with defining visual content superior to conventional videos, agile creation of such content, and making it automatically discoverable over the net. Prior to joining GS Labs, Atul was a fellow at Strand Genomics Bangalore, architecting the flagship data mining and scientific visualization product, Avaris, from Strand. Avaris is currently deployed with all premier R&D pharmaceutical organizations throughout the world, as well as the bioinformatics departments in universities and research labs. Earlier, Atul was a member of high-end graphics group at Silicon Graphics Incorporated, Mountain View, California, where he worked on graphics, microcode, and compilers for vector programming and custom graphic accelerators. Atul holds an MS in Computer Science from University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, and BTech in Computer Science Engineering from IIT Bombay. Over to you, Atul.
Hello all, I'm Atul, and it's a pleasure to be here to talk about some of the pioneering contributors in various fields of computer science. And since I have some acquaintance with graphics, because during my grad studies and later work, I thought I'd talk about Ivan Sutherland and his pioneering contributions to specifically human-computer interaction. And like I think Mukund mentioned, many people compared him, they have not heard of him as much. Because, you know, all his work was done really in 60s and 70s, the graphics work. And the bulk of his contributions were the early part of the decades there, before it became glamorous to kind of form companies in Silicon Valley and kind of make money. But he was really, his contributions to computer graphics are really fundamental, and he's actually called the father of computer graphics. So I'd love to spend some time going over his contributions. Any questions, you can interrupt me anytime. So Ivan Sutherland won the Turing Award in 1988, and if you look at the wordings, they say for his pioneering and visionary contributions to graphics, starting with Sketchpad and continuing thereafter. So Sketchpad was the first GUI slash CAD computer-aided design program in the world. And it was actually demonstrated in 1963, which is 50 years ago. And that single program, which was his PhD thesis, introduced so many novel concepts at that time, which found the foundation of contemporary graphics, as well as some other fields, and let's go through some of them. So Ivan's contributions span multiple areas, and the primary being graphical user interface, also applied to CAD. He was the originator of virtual reality, and we'll talk about some of his work which he has done in that space. Computer graphics in general. And after graphics, he actually focused his attention more on integrated circuits, and specifically asynchronous circuits. So not the clock ones, but the circuits which do not have a clock. And that has been his research for the last 20 odd years, and so on. So Ivan Sutherland's doctoral dissertation at MIT was groundbreaking work, which originated the field of graphics. So he called it Sketchpad, and the title for that was, it was meant to be a system to facilitate man-machine communication. Like we know in those days, and we're talking about early 60s, all programming was done on paper tapes, and there were these big drum memories and magnetic memories. And Ivan Sutherland came up with a program with a system where you could actually interact with the computer and draw drawings on it in a very intuitive manner, where there was no mouse, where there was no keyboard, and some of this, and we'll have a look at how it was done. So this was done in 1963, which is 50 years ago, and it still amazes me what he was able to achieve with so little at his disposal at that point of time. So it was, like I said, the first graphical interface GUI ever publicly demonstrated. So, Ivan Sutherland worked at, he did his graduation at MIT, at Lincoln Labs. And MIT was at forefront of all research activities that time as well as now, of course. It had a lot of funding from US government, especially in the defense, and a lot of work on computers, radars, electronics, among other disciplines. So Lincoln Labs had this computer called TS2, and it was designed right there in the lab itself by a person called Wes Clark. And its purpose was to facilitate human-computer interaction. I mean, that was the purpose of this computer. There were many others lying around. to explore ways of talking to a machine without using paper tapes, which was the primary way of interaction at that point of time. So it had a 7-inch CRT and 512 by 512 pixels, an oscilloscope kind of thing, and a light pen. I'll talk about it. It was, think of it like a mouse, which would identify a XY location on the display, so point to a 2D, 2-dimensional coordinate, a button box with a few buttons. Again, think of it like a keyboard, a few buttons you could press and they would send some instructions to the computer. And the good thing was, I mean, one different thing about this computer was, this was entirely transistor based, because this was also a testing ground for transistor based computers. Those time, predominantly most of the computers were driven by vacuum tubes. This was transistor based. And a lot of grad students got time to play with this machine. And Ivan Sutherland, he says in his, in some, I think, some publication there, that he used to work from 3 to 6 every morning, because that was the only slot available for new students like him. So 3 a.m. to 6 a.m. and day after day, where he kind of worked on building SketchPad. So this is what the console of TX2 looked like. So that time this was revolutionary, because there was actually a computer with a display. The computers had no displays, right? And there's a button box, you'll see another picture of it later, which would, you press off a button, send some, activated some flip-flop, and send some command to the computer. This was a memory bank. It had capacity for 70,000 words. Okay, and each word, I don't remember, maybe 20 bits or 24 bits. That is all. That's all the memory this giant machine had. And Ivan built this system, he built this SketchPad system on this computer. So one of the, I think, new things he did was use this device called light pen, right? So if you see this, as you move the light pen, a cursor appears on the oscilloscope. So exactly identical to a mouse which we used to it. But it's this came off from the SAGE project. So the US government in the early 50s has sponsored a semi-automatic ground environment or something like that. That's the name of the system. It was a radar complex where radars were used to track aeroplanes and nuclear weapons and so on, Soviet missiles. And they were linked through communication links. So all these radar stations all over the US talked through telephone lines. Okay, and this was one of the devices used to identify objects on the radar scopes. So the radar operators used to find if there is an unknown object appearing on the scope, they pointed this pen to it, and that was used to identify the object. So the way it worked is also fascinating, right? So there is a you have a small program which is drawing a raster beam on the computer, right? It's painting the computer display row by row, and wherever there was a pen, if the pen was near some pixel, the pen would interpret that the beam of the CRT is nearby, is within the focus, and it would interrupt the computer. And you could actually, instead of the rasterization process was interrupted, and you jump to a routine which was a pen routine, which could actually draw the cursor and do something more, and then the rasterization continued. So it was actually interrupting the raster process, the pen interrupted the process, and it was used to find out what object was drawn at that point of time, because the computer knew, I am drawing object X, and I got an interrupt, which means this is an object X. So Ivan Sutherland's ingenuity lay in the fact that he used it as a drawing device rather than just a pointing and recognition device. Okay, and so this is a photo of Ivan Sutherland as a PhD student there working with the TX2 console. This is a sketchpad program. This is a primitive button box, he called, keyboard kind of thing. And there you see him drawing on the computer using the pen. Okay. So I have a small video which I'd like to play. I think the video makes it much more easier to appreciate it.
Sketchpad developments back in 1961, and it remained a program, this machine, so it would
So this is not Ivan Zarlik, some of his colleagues at the lab.
How do you actually go about communicating with a computer in the graphical sense?
Well, I use an oscilloscope here, which is much like a TV set, except it's being driven by the computer. In order to get the information into the computer, we have to draw somehow on this display. And we use the light pen. Well, in order to construct a meaningful engineering drawing, we have to have several graphical manipulations.
Look, it's used just like similar to mouse.
Ivan Sullivan's programs can draw straight lines and circles.
Well, that's about what you do in a drafting equipment anyway, isn't it?
That's a very good start. In order to do this, we can position this white spot in the middle of the cross that you notice at a desired location. And we press the button to command the computer to draw a line. It will draw a line from this position where I am now to any subsequent position of my light pen. This is much like a rubber band stuck in two pins. One is nailed on the screen here, and the other is at my light pen. So I can position this anywhere I want. Now I'm going to draw a second line. And even the third one. Now, in an ordinary pencil and paper drawing, all we have is this particular picture. But the computer understands the geometry of the drawing here. What do I mean? I mean that if I point at this particular point and tell the computer to move that point by another push button command, it will move not only that point, but all three lines that are attached to it.
And the delay between it's doing what you want it to is because it's computing all these changes.
That's correct. Now, if I made a mistake...
So just like a pause for a minute. See, what we see here, I mean, now it's all kind of seems very, very trivial. But you know, this was done on a system which had no line drawing algorithms. So you have to first figure out how to draw a line, a dot by dot. This machine did not have an OS. So all programming was done via macros on this paper tape. And the system didn't have a concept of a mouse. So everything you see was done by the sketchpad system. Yeah. Which was a tremendous amount of effort to get it done.
I could delete my mistake by pointing at the line in question, for instance, and pressing the appropriate button. It's gone.
The system could draw circles.
The computer knows that those must be connected. It turns out that they're not really connected. It's a very small nub there. Let me move this away and show you that they're really not connected. But I have told it by terminating the point of the pen at that position that it must be connected. Now, I can tell a computer to satisfy this constraint command by bringing in a program under command that is toggle. And watch this go. You see now that indeed the circle is ending at that line. Constraint in drawing to behave this way.
Well, I wonder if you'd expand a little more on this idea of a constraint. Just what do you mean?
Let's say I'm beginning a design. I have a very nebulous idea what I want to have in mind.
So, and
as I draw my part, let's say,
I'm not merely a drawing
tool. It reinforces what I have in mind.
It's supposed to just most
the general constraints part of the design process. And as I apply design criteria, stresses, and so on,
eventually
I will know what the exact shape of this part is. I shouldn't be required to draw the exact shape at the beginning. I really don't know what it is. But let's say I've decided eventually in this model that I want these to be horizontal and vertical, a box. I can apply a new constraint, a horizontal constraint here, and a vertical constraint here, and a horizontal here by pointing at the line and pressing a button. Well, now nothing has happened yet because remember I still must tickle that toggle over there to command the computer to satisfy these constraints.
So you won't actually let those rubber bands relax then until you say so.
Right. And I'll do that. And watch again. There we have a box.
Well, now this idea of having constraints like this, being able to make lines meet or to make them horizontal or vertical, makes it quite a step ahead of something that's just a drafting machine that allows you to draw.
Exactly. In other words, you can get the topology down of the part, and at any subsequent position in your design, you can make it behave exactly what you want. Straighten the drawing up. In other words, you don't have to draw exactly at the beginning.
I think it looks something like that.
What I've done is I regard that first picture as a master. Mm-hmm. I call up a copy of it, and I can manipulate it locally. I can reduce it,
so here you see,
magnify it. I can rotate
zooming,
it.
Rotation, scaling of objects, and all coming into this system.
And I can do this several times. This is, of course, very
interesting
for repetitive drawings, ridge bays, where we have several repetitive structures.
Oh, if you were drawing a circuit diagram, you might have little resistors or transistors or something already drawn and stored away, and you could call up as many of those as you wanted.
Right. Now, imagine that when I was doing my design work, I made a mistake in my measurement. Well, in order to correct that mistake, it would go back, and let's say I don't really want this circuit or segment to be in here. I erase it. Now I have the problem of making these changes to all the occurrences of this copy in my working drawing. This is very tedious nowadays. With pencil and paper, we have to remember where all the changes are. Now you notice, you remember the drawing, that we now have lost our circular arcs.
So if the manufacturer, for instance, of some electronic part changed the design somewhere one of these years, you could just automatically change all the drawings in which it appeared.
Correct. Well, now I've showed you many basic graphical manipulations we have available.
Incidentally, I would like to ask you how big this piece of paper that you keep referring to is, and how many pieces of paper you have available to you.
Well, this scope, which measures about 7 inches on the side, we regard this as a window that we can move over our paper and enlarge the size of this window. We can imagine the computer as a fixed sheet of paper behind this window. Its scale is approximately 2 miles on the side.
2 miles?
Right. And let's look at that. I can reduce this drawing slightly. And let me call up a copy of that master drawing again. Put it over the center there.
This is zooming and scaling.
Oops.
Right? You want to see a small part of your... They were talking about engineering drawings at that time. Because the purpose of Sketchpad was...
I've hit one stop already.
Drawings.
That's as small as you can. You're looking at the whole piece of paper. So.
Correct. And let me magnify it now. And now it's magnified so it's practically off the screen. Place another one in there.
Sort of like the picture within a picture within a picture idea.
Right, it's real nightmare material.
As it gets smaller, even though the spot sort of disappears, it's really still there, isn't it?
Right, the computer has this all memorized in its memory.
Okay, so Sketchpad, as you must have seen from this video, was a seminal piece of work which introduced several very, very novel and fundamental concepts which form the core of graphics and computer-aided design to this day. Right, so in those days, this was magic, right? All being done by very primitive computers through this very different user interaction paradigm. So this is an excerpt from Ivan Sutherland's PhD thesis, the technical report, right? And he says this is a system. The intention was to make man and computer talk more rapidly. Right? In those days it was very painful to paper tape. I haven't seen a paper tape or a punch card, so I can really imagine that. But it will be really painful. So he says that instead of communicating with a computer with written statements which we have to be typed, you can actually draw things and communicate concepts to the computer far more easily in a more natural manner. Right? And one of the biggest things it does is it opens up computer communication to non-specialists. You no longer have to be a electrical, electronics, computer science engineer to understand how to communicate with the machine. Anybody with sufficient training could use this kind of a system and maybe get their engineering drawings done. Right? That was its purpose of making the understand. And the graphical user interface ideas he presented really met a huge amount of success with that respect. So what I'm going to do is next few minutes, I'm just going to talk through a few things he brought forth in Sketchpad and to see how they relate to modern computer graphics and some of the other programming concepts we are all used to, right? So, I'll go through a few innovations in Sketchpad. So, Sketchpad was the first system to define some kind of a recursive storage for a graphical scene, right? So, your large object is composed of a number of small objects, you know, like a car. Car is composed of a main frame, then four doors, rotated and translated, then four wheels, again with some rotation and translation. And this all put together makes a car, right? So He defined a storage methodology where your main master drawing is composed of a series of objects along with transforms, and that specifies the entire topology of your drawing. Right? He did something extra, which was constraints. This is really, I think, separate. But this kind of storage and this hierarchy of defining graphical scenes, it was a precursor to the modern scene graph. So this is called scene graph today, right? How do you define a street scene? A visual scene is composed of a lot of objects, and it's a graph, directed acyclic graph. And the storage structure he refers to in his paper was the first scene graph to ever appear. And I think around 70 to 80% of the concept scene produced at this time still part of the current scene graph APIs, various scene graph APIs you see in graphic systems. Right? So and his description of evaluation or rendering of a scene graph is accurate 50 days later, even now. Right? What he says is, to display an instance of a paper of a picture, you find which parts of the picture need to be shown, and then you draw at a particular instance, and you recursively expand to further parts of the picture. Right? And this is true of at a very high level, course level of all graphical systems today, graphic systems. This is how they render complex scenes consisting of multiple objects. Right? And his methodology of how transformations are composed together, how matrices which define the transformation of objects in the scene graph are multiplied together to compound or join on the transform, stays accurate to this day. Right? And this is exactly how scene graph APIs work today. So just to expand, right? I just have a few slides. So this is a sample airplane, and we say airplane is composed of a wing, a fuselage is the main body, and there's a wings and there are some propellers, and it's composed of these many objects, and at each location you draw this object and apply some transformation to place it correctly with respect to the main fuselage or the main object, right? And then you add on other smaller objects. All of these are copies of the same object because they are identical. The left engine is same as the right engine. It just appears at a different location, and so on. So this is how a scene graph, a basic scene graph, looks at a high level. And then you add transforms to it, right? So if I were to draw a bicycle, right? Very simplistic example, you would first draw a frame, then you would translate by some distance and draw a wheel, which would be the rear wheel. And if you translate to the right, and you translate to the right, it's the front wheel, and you translate to the left, then it's the rear wheel, right? This is what is we use today too, right? And this is what was described in Sketchfab in 1963. And if you look today, right, now this is again maybe around 10 years old, open inventor scene graph, the scene graph have gradually become very, very complicated. As people want more special effects and better looking graphics, realistic rendering, right? So with each scene graph node, you can actually define your material of your polygonal surface. Is it diffuse? Is it specular? Is it shiny? Where is the light shining from? What are the translations, rotations, and so on, right? So the modern scene graphs have become much more complicated, but the basis was set by what we saw in Sketchfab. It was also one of the first interactive CAD programs. And the intention for Sketchpad was to draw 2D drawings, right? And hence we had limited to drawing using lines and circles, right? We had not worked with any other kind of objects. And so it was a 2D CAD system. It had a constraint specification system, like we saw, right? These two points, they are joined. So if one of the endpoints is moved, then both the lines move because they share an endpoint. The concept of rubber banding, where you draw an approximate shape and use constraints to stitch things together, or you go to the right final precise shape from the approximate shape, was introduced here. The notion of copy paste, right, like we saw in this system, right? Once you have an object, by pressing a toggle button, another copy of that object appears and you can do whatever with it. The concept of drag and drop. Right. Once you have an object, how do you know where to place it? So it was being dragged by the light pen and dropped at the right location. So all of these concepts which we are very familiar with today first made appearance in Sketchpad, right? So another thing which Sketchpad did was formalize the notion of coordinate spaces in graphics. Like we saw towards the end of the video, the drawing is really huge, but the computer on the console is really is focusing on a small part of the drawing, a viewport. What is it that you can see? And when you move it to the left or right, you can see other parts of the drawing which are hidden before. So this concept of a viewport, where viewport is this, let's say, a small window through which you are looking into this drawing, and all you can see is the V, right? Because that's what your screen is showing, but the drawing is much larger. So you're translating from page coordinates, which is this entire drawing, to the scope coordinates, which is your viewport, to eliminate things which are not seen, and to only draw items of the lines of interest, which are visible. So the notion of zooming, viewport, clipping is extremely important in graphics, right? If you look at a scene like this, now this is not from Sketchpad, I just picked it up from the web somewhere. This is hundreds of lines, probably thousands of lines. And if you were to draw these, your rendering rates would slow down. Your system would slow down quite a bit. So in rendering, it's more important what not to draw than what to draw. Because often, 90% of the scene is invisible. So you should have an ability to make very fast decisions about throwing away that 90% and only focusing on the 10% which you need to draw. So in this, all of these lines would never be rendered. Because you're wasting computing cycles. And you should be drawing only things which are inside this. So this actually led to further research in clipping algorithms. And Sutherland himself has a very well-known clipping algorithm, Sutherland Cohen line clipping algorithm, his name, I think around 1966 or 67. And all with a focus on implementing in hardware, right? Because graphic systems are real-time systems, and their performance is critical. And so all the publications he has actually are, and you'll see it later in the presentation, with a focus on hardware implementation. So you can actually go do much better, right? So say you have these three objects, and this is your small viewport, right? You would not draw this object because it's completely outside your screen, right? No, not spent cycles. But how do you figure it out? How do you find out whether it's outside your screen, right? So what Ivan Sutherland did was he came up with a simple heuristic that every object has a bounding box, or he called it a bounding frame. He says it lies between this x max, x min, y max, and y min. And it's a very simple test to see if these two rectangles don't overlap. If the rectangles of the viewport rectangle and the bounding box of the object don't overlap, don't even attempt drawing it, however complex it might be, right? So every node in the scene graph has a bounding box, which can be quickly tested with a viewport. It's a simple math, integer comparison, which can be implemented in hardware, which will let you know whether to draw this or not. Right? And that actually led to substantial research in what we call as culling. Culling refers to not drawing parts of the scene because they are not visible. So one example I'd like to point out, and this happened. So what Ivan Sutherland did was his bounding boxes were axis aligned, right? The box was vertical, the lines were vertical and horizontal, right? And so, but it was not always efficient, right? For example, here, this gray area is your screen, which is visible, but this bounding box for X, which is the right leg, still intersects the screen. So you actually attempt drawing X, and then figure out, okay, nothing is visible. You would have spent compute cycles drawing out that rectangle of that object X. So if you instead have axis aligned bounding boxes, it is possible to make a more intelligent decision. But now your hardware has become more complicated because you have to deal with rectangles which are not axis aligned, which could be rotated. So you have to work with angles instead of just XY comparison. Right? So anyway, if you look at the current culling algorithms, they're of huge complexity, and people always want more and more performance. So, when Sutherland was later asked about Sketchpad, right? And so this was his comment about Sketchpad, right? So the main purpose with which he created Sketchpad is that a digital display rendering graphics is a great way to gain familiarity with concepts which are not realizable in the physical world. So with a computer, we have a lot of leeway in trying out how things would look like, how things would be positioned, which is really hard for us to imagine, for most of us to imagine. I'm just thinking about it, right? So mathematics becomes tractable or amenable when you actually render it on the display graphically, and you can make more sense out of it more easily. Okay. So there's another huge contribution of Sketchpad, which I think Ivan Zerline didn't set out to achieve, but I think it happened as while he was implementing the Sketchpad system. And so he made a clear distinction between generic code and specific code, right? Because his Sketchpad system drew points, lines, circles. Then it had intersection routines for where the circle intersects with the screen, line intersects with the screen. Point is very easy, trivial. And there were a lot of manipulations on these objects. There were objects were put together, scaled, zoomed, and so on. And so this is from his thesis that he says functions are developed which make no reference to the specific types. Right? So these are generic functions, independent of the specific type. So this is code which is applicable to all objects. All instances was the word he used, right? And so you want to make functions as general as possible because you want to get as much reuse from your programming effort. You've written your code to rotate. I want to use the same code to rotate all of my objects. And I don't want to write separate code for rotating a circle, rotating a line, rotating a point, and so on. So, and this starts looking familiar like object-oriented programming. Thing we talked about, right? There's generic and specific. So there's a master class and there's a derived class which shares some common properties of the master class, right? So general functions are implemented in Sketchpad and independent of the specific subject matter of the pictures, right? So without calling this classes and objects, he actually arrived at this. His methodology of representing the graphical scene used all concepts from object-oriented programming, right? So the general part will only perform a few basic parts, drawing actions, and calling help from routines for specific parts. Right? This is what we do today. Right? There's a general part, and you have object-specific implementations of the methods. Either they are overridden from your master class or abstract class, or they are part of the interface which the objects implement. And the big power of this clear-cut separation is it's easy to change the details of the specific parts without needing to change the general parts. Again, this is what OOPS wants to achieve. So when we saw in the video, right, there was a master drawing and there was an instance drawing. So there was this arc he had drawn and he made several copies of those arcs and placed near the rectangle. This is like copying from a master and making multiple instances, which maps directly to classes and instances, right? So he didn't use the terminology which we are familiar with today in the thesis, but I think he made it very clear that this was a very important contribution of Sketchpad in his opinion. He said this programming style should be adopted, and in fact he had made a note in the thesis one place saying, I would be reluctant to programming in any other way given the advantage of separating the generics and the specifics in this manner. So let me see, I think I had the note somewhere. It was there somewhere. Yes. So the rewards that come with implementing general functions are so great that the author has become reluctant to write any programs for specific jobs. Right? But the first guy is saying, these are the benefits I'm getting from OOPS. This was at a time when object-oriented programming was not, I think, there. It came about later. So the Sketchpad system was in some way a precursor to object-oriented programming, which we are all familiar with, and it's kind of established all around today. And here we see a confirmation of this. So Alan Kay, who's the creator of Smalltalk, the first object-oriented programming language, says at Utah, he did his PhD at Utah where Sutherland was a professor. Influenced by Sketchpad, Simula, and design of ARPANET and so on, I thought of an architecture for programming. And when somebody asked me what it was, I said it's object-oriented programming. Right? So he, among others, right, Sketchpad is not the only inspiration. Sketchpad is one of the inspirations for Alan Kay's creation of this object-oriented programming concept. Interestingly, Alan Kay himself was a Turing Award recipient. And Ivan Sutherland was his PhD thesis, on his PhD thesis committee. I don't know whether he's an advisor or not. So I think a case of student and a teacher both getting Turing Awards. So after 1963, Ivan Sutherland left MIT and he joined US Army. I think those days this military commission was compulsory after the World War days. And he ended up working with an organization called Information Processing Techniques Office, which was part of ARPA. So the US government was spending huge sums of money those days, even now, for fundamental R&D, mostly directed toward Cold War, also catching up with the Soviets in the space race and various other reasons. Right? So he was one of the youngest heads there at the age of 26. He headed this entire division. And there's a very interesting article he published that time where he talked about his vision of an ultimate display. He had always been working with, and he started working in this area now. And he was looking at driving research in several universities and corporations in the US at display technologies. And he published a small one-pager, two-pager article called The Ultimate Display. And I want to go through it briefly so that, you know, I would like all of us to appreciate his visionary predictions, most of which have come true today after so many years. So let me quickly show this. Okay. So this is. Oops. I'm just moving it here. Okay. So this is something he published in 65, right? And it says if you want to understand the capabilities of a physical world, you should have a nice way to visualize it, right? And this is where he makes this quote that a display connected to a computer gives us the ability to do this, which is not possible using pure math alone. So in those days, computers had the ability to only do line plot dots, right? Now he predicted that there will be computers which will be able to draw curves as well. And this in fact became a reality just few years later when Bezier curves were introduced by Bezier in France, Dassault systems, and then non-uniform rational NURBS, non-uniform rational B-splines, beta-splines, and today such curved surfaces are used routinely for creating realistic graphical scenes. He also talked about the ability of a computer to render pictures, images, and movies, which was not there at that time, which we see very commonly today. So displays with area filling capability, right? So filled polygons leading to images and then later to movies. He says the mechanism for direct computer input today was the typewriter, which was used to type the punch cards. He says the typewriter consoles will become a primary way to interact with the computers, which is keyboards. And the user will interact with the computer like a typewriter. He ought to know how to touch type. So, which is, I mean, all of us, we need to know that to efficiently work with a computer. He talks about input devices like the light pen and the RAND tablet, which is very similar to the mouse today. This talks about you can change some things on the screen by merely writing what on top of it. So this is like drag and drop. You have to change contents of the register. You just point to the first register and drag it onto the second. Something which we are all familiar with today. Knobs and joysticks, which we have joysticks for gaming consoles and so on. Okay, I think a lot of these things are covered. So, I just wanted to show this, to see that this was his vision of driving research at ARPA, and which he spent money on by funding several university programs all around the US to achieve that. And some of them were achieved in very early and some of them took a long time. So the next thing he worked on was virtual reality, and the first virtual reality system he built was demonstrated in 1968, 45 years ago, right, when the field is still somewhat considered esoteric. So he and his team at Harvard, so he went to Harvard after ARPA, his stint at ARPA. Built a head-mounted display. So the idea was that you're looking at a complex scene. Why do you have to look at it through a two-dimensional console? Can I be a part of the scene and immerse myself in the scene? Right? That way I'll get a better understanding of the space. So the idea was to surround the user with 3D information. So you are part of the scene. And you make the interface very natural. Instead of moving a mouse or a joystick to control the camera, why not let your eyes be the camera itself? So put a helmet kind of thing in your face, and wherever you look, the scene should change accordingly. And that was this concept which led to the HMD system, which was the first virtual reality and augmented reality system in the world. So the concept of HMD, it was not new. There were head-mounted displays at that time, but they were all linked to live cameras. Remote closed circuit cameras. So essentially, if you're working in a hazardous place, you might have something maybe which is full of some gas or radiation and so on. So there's a remote camera, and you could put on a helmet, and as you move the head-mounted display, the camera changed, and you could see those displays. So there was a company called Philco which built this in 1961. But Sutherland was different. You're actually rendering graphics. Graphical scenes. It was not just a camera input which was being shown in there. So let's look at how he went about building the system, which ended up laying the foundation for modern computer graphics hardware, which I'm sure Sanjeev will talk about later. So this was a system. He called it Sword of Damocles because it was suspended from the ceiling, and it was all a setup which was people worried what time it could fall down. So he had two mechanisms, right? If you see here, there's a rod which is coming from the ceiling, which actually connects to the helmet. So as you move around, the rod rotates around this pivot on the ceiling. And so there are four sensors in the rod, which tells you where is the XY for that rod in the room. And there are two more sensors on the head mount, which tells you the rotation or the perspective for the head mount. Right? So with the 6 degrees of freedom, four covered on the rod and two more on the helmet, you could actually move around a little bit, whatever range it offered, and you could figure out where the person was looking at, where the person is and where they are looking at. Right? The camera location and the perspective, both were the inputs made possible. He had also devised another system because people felt it's clumsy to have a big iron rod attached from my head to the ceiling, right? So move away from any mechanical contraption. So he built something which is based on ultrasound. So there were four ultrasound receivers in these four sticks suspended from the ceiling, and there were three transmitters on this head mount. And based on the time required to, I don't know these details myself, this is my reading from the paper, they could figure out from the time required from the waves to go from the sound waves to go from the helmet to the sensor where the location was. So, and I think the great thing about Ivan Sutherland's projects and all work he did were they were all realizable implementations. And not only did he come up with fundamental new theory, he actually made it possible and he showed working prototypes of all of them. Right? So this was the system here, and Let me show you, I have another small video I found on YouTube about this. Okay. It's a very small video. This is how the system looks like. There's no audio here. So this is Ivan Sutherland himself putting on this system. You can see the mechanical rod they are giving. And he's actually looking at this cube from multiple directions. As he moves around, he's looking at this cube from different sides. And so the object was very simple, the cube. And what you saw behind was the room itself. So the room, imagery of the room was mixed with the graphical object, and he could view the scene. Okay, so what's so great about this, right? I mean, of course it's great in terms of the result it achieved, but the way it was designed, I think it survives to this day with very little change. So it was the first real-time graphics system which had a dedicated graphics hardware. So the compute power you needed to show the scene from the, that dynamically, right? Every time your perspective changed, you have to re-render the scene, was not available in computers those days. And so he ended up implementing dedicated hardware to all graphics computation. So this was the first graphics pipeline implemented in hardware, dedicated graphics work taken away from the main CPU and the main computer to be done into a pipeline, right? Which is the de facto norm today. GPUs offload everything from CPUs, right? He worked with Bob Sproul on this. Bob Sproul built some of the hardware in this, and they ended up becoming long time associates and continue to be to this day. So this is from his paper, 1968 paper, where he described this system. So there's a mechanical system attached to this mount, which gives you what it gives you is a head position. This head position data goes to the computer. So the computer is no use for very limited things. So all it gets is from this big complicated system, it gets the 6 readings based on which it figures out where the user is and where they are looking at. 2 parameters. And then they are feeding the drawing, which in this case was a cube, but it could be a very complex drawing. So the computer is only doing 2 things: throwing up down the vertices for the drawings and determining the position of the camera and where they are looking at based on whatever parameters might be there in the system, detection system. And all the 3 boxes you see here below are implemented in hardware. So there was dedicated hardware for this which implemented this, right? And so let me go through a simple concept before I explain this, so it's very apparent. So the transformation part of the graphics pipeline is very similar to the real world. Okay, it mirrors what happens in the real world. So let's say in the real world, you put a camera on a tripod, right? So you're identifying where my camera is, right? At the same time, you're also identifying where it is looking. Right, so you are identifying where the camera is looking, and you are fixing the position and the direction, both of which were done by this hardware on top of the head for Sutherland. The next part is you place your model, which is your scene, whatever you are trying to render, molecules, cars, graphics objects, buildings, and so on. Right, so that's called a model. So the model and the view are the 2 key parts of how imagery gets into the camera. And now the next part is, once you have image into your camera, which could be an eye by the way, you project it. So in the external 3D world is projected into a 2-dimensional retina, right? And so that there's a projection step. And finally, you actually realize the object by let's say capturing on a screen or a photograph. You can make it bigger or smaller by zooming and so on. So that's called the viewport transform. See, these 4 major steps in the real world are mirrored into the graphics pipeline for the vertex processing part, right? And Sutherland's matrix multiplier, he called it a matrix multiplier, realized all these 4 steps into a dedicated hardware system, right? So They actually went out and built small modules, units, hardware pieces of hardware, which are capable of doing matrix multiplication, because you represent a coordinates in x, y, z, w, the homogeneous coordinate system. You multiply by the 16 by 16 matrix to transform, rotate, scale. So all of these multiplications are done at once, because you need to do it fast. The perspective division, where you are projecting into from 3D to 2D, and the clipping, determining what to render and what not to render. Right? And remember, what is important is what not to render, because that's bulk of the design. Now, each module was independently timed. And so I'll go through it, why it has to be that way. And the vertex data essentially streams through this pipeline, and you see the object. The pipeline is doing the job. So this design was fairly novel. It was non-trivial. The reason is, if you look at the matrix multiplier, all it's doing is taking a vector multiplying by a matrix, right, for each vertex. This is a fixed time operation. It needs fixed amount of time, because you're doing multiply and then add. So this piece of unit works at a deterministic rate. Whereas the clipping actually does division. And division is not a fixed time operation. The time you need for the division, especially when you need to iterate, depends on the number, the size of the number, the value of a number. So the clipping unit could operate at a slower pace than the multiplication unit, which means you need to have a FIFO, input-output FIFO, for all of these units, so that data which is ready here, but this unit is not ready to accept, sits in a temporary stack array, and when this gets ready, it picks up transform vertices for processing. Same thing for the analog line driver. So note, this was not a raster display, this was a vector display, whatever we had inside. So the time required to draw a line is variable based on the length of the line. Short line you can draw very fast, a long line takes long time, because the CRT beam takes long time to traverse that distance. Right? So all units operated at different speeds, and what they worked on was a mechanism, FIFO based mechanism, to make this whole thing work together, right? And at a whatever predefined average speed which they wanted. And so this was, like I said, the first hardware dedicated graphics hardware pipeline the world had seen, and this is really. And I'll show you what the current pipeline looks like. So this was started very simple, and now, because of functionality demand, it's ended up becoming quite complex. So if you look at the current OpenGL specification, the basic vertex transformation pipeline described in OpenGL is virtually identical to the one described in this 1968 paper by Sutherland and Straub. The use of homogeneous coordinate 4x4 matrices transforms exact, everything holds true to this day. Right? Of course, there is much more added beyond this than was there at his time. He was looking for the transformation. So this is what, I don't want to go through this. This is what the current pipeline looks like. I mean, it is a big state machine, a lot of pixel shading, vertex shading, textures, normals, kind of thing. I'm sure Sanjeev will refer to some of this in his talk. Right? So, but I think what is important to realize is the origins of this lay in a very audacious experiment done in the late 60s by Ivan and his students. So it was also in some sense the first augmented reality system. Augmented reality systems are kind of becoming the talk of the day today. And if you saw in that video, you could see a room as well as a drawing. Right? So what he did was, there was a prism. So the room could be seen, at the same time the graphics object could be seen through the half mirrored prism, and both combined into one scene. Very basic. But so that way you could have a bearing for your environment as well as look at the graphics at the same time. And you see augmented reality systems appearing today, especially with these mobile phones, right? So you're looking at a cat through your pointer camera to location, and it will then superimpose some map data on top of it, or some hotel data, restaurant data, whatever, show you in a combined manner. But the origins of this also lay in this research. Sutherland, after Harvard, he went to Utah, Salt Lake City. He was a professor at computer science department. And this department, in those 6 to 7 years, just created wonders. I mean, it was an explosion of activity, especially in computer graphics, from University of Utah those days. And I think virtually all the significant research and discoveries originated from Utah in some way, or there were linkage to Utah department, computer science department, in some way or another. At the same time, he founded a company called Evans & Sutherland in Salt Lake City with Professor David Evans, who was the founder of computer science department in Utah. So both of them founded this company, and they were also running the university. The university did research at the leading edge. They got funding from DARPA to do that, and they productized that research via Evans & Sutherland, building real-time graphic systems to bring it to the real world. So it was that way, very symbiotic of what we see in the Silicon Valley these days, right? R&D translating into industry, right? So pioneering company in real-time hardware and accelerated 3D graphics, continued to be a leader till mid-80s. So just to give you some idea of I mentioned it was the heyday of graphics at the University of Utah. The people who Evans & Sutherland worked with, who were his students and who were also worked at Evans & Sutherland. Alan Kay was a student who created Smalltalk and the windowing GUI at Xerox PARC subsequently. Henry Gouraud was also a student. He introduced Gouraud shading, which is a way to shade polygons or triangles. When you move from wireframe to shaded surfaces, Gouraud shading came from him. Ed Catmull, who invented texture mapping, so you can overlay images on objects, so you can wrap around images on objects, right? That's crude description of texture mapping. Who also worked in animation, and he later co-founded Pixar, Disney. He's a president of Disney today, I think. Ed Catmull. Frank Rowe, again, a student who invented anti-aliasing, how to show lines without jaggies. Right? So you see, when you look at line drawings and they are not on a straight plane, you see the jaggies. So he found a way to eliminate those jaggies and how to draw smooth lines even if they are not along axis line. Jim Clark, who created the first geometry pipeline in 1983 or so, and founded Silicon Graphics and Netscape. So on later. John Warmack was a student who founded PostScript and Adobe later. So all these guys working together in a small group, working in the areas of graphics, tremendous amount of energy in that place. There are others too, but I'm just limited to ones related to Ivan Sutherland. Just a few words about Evans & Sutherland. Founded to produce hardware. To realize all these bright ideas coming out of research and all the students at Utah. And they focused on using computers as simulators. And the market they got into was building flight simulators, mostly for military and commercial aircraft. Those days, I think the simulators were only mechanical. They added this element of graphics, collaborating with a company called Green Diffusion in the UK. And they produced some of the leading flight simulators of the day. And continued until late 80s. And they also worked in areas like molecular visualization. So leaders in real-time graphics until late 80s, when they were really overtaken by others like Silicon Graphics and all, and subsequently the NVIDIA and ATS. So if you look at Evans, until now we have only looked at wireframe drawings. So Evans and Sutherland actually went with a proposal to DARPA, saying, no, we should have the ability to show shaded surfaces, polygonal surfaces, while able to line drawings. We believe we can make computers of that kind. So this was something, a proposed thing, right? This is what they went to DARPA with, the proposal. We can do things of this kind. Okay? And they, over the next years, mid 1975 to 1980 and beyond, Evans and Sullivan produced leading edge graphics engines in the market, starting with shading, Pixel and Fog came much later. But you see the images starting getting more and more realistic. Right? They were crude so far, now they look more and more realistic. And so I want to show you a short clip of by 1981 how much things have progressed from that very basic head-mounted display we saw in 1968. Right? So this CT5 was a flight simulator produced in collaboration with Evans and Sutherland and Reedy Fusion. So the pilot sat in this box and there were hydraulics, hydraulically operated. And as it simulated the flying of an aircraft for the pilot, surrounded by graphics, surrounded by screens, simulating the view the pilot would see from the cockpit. Right? So let's have a quick look at kind of
CH-46 helicopters. And yet this one's just a little different. In fact, it's a simulation. The first simulation ever to take advantage of a new era of computer-generated image visual systems. The Reedy Fusion and Evans and Sutherland CT-5.
I've got them. I'll call dead on it.
As these formation sequences show, CT-5 is the most operationally capable CGI visual ever developed. Its ability to display very high levels of scene content through wide fields of view means that crews under training receive realistic visual cues. Advanced modeling techniques allow full mission tactical scenarios like these to be practiced in total safety. The CT-5 visual system installed on this Reflectone CH-46 simulator is the first of three CT-5s for Marine Corps helicopter pilot flight training. A unique feature of CT-5 is its ability to color blend polygons in the model scene. This color blending is used to portray the F-16 afterburners with a high degree of realism.
So not only were the scenes rendered, they were rendered at 60 frames per second. Actually twice the television rate. So we need more realism.
Database surfaces may also be modeled as transparent. As we take a sidelong view of the formation, notice that the canopies are in fact transparent and that the pilots are visible inside the aircraft. Follow a single F-16 close up as it executes an aileron roll. Because of the high scene capacity of the system, considerable detail may still be seen on the ground below. As the F-16 begins its roll, the shading on the fuselage changes to reflect the orientation of the aircraft relative to the position of the model sun.
So this was, like I said, I would like to reiterate, in 1981, where any of these things, SDA was not even formed at that point of time. Right? I think the only reason why Evans and Sutherland is not as well known outside the graphics community is because it really catered to a very niche market of high-end systems and defense and government and so on. It never got into personal computing and general purpose scientific computing and so on.
Any idea what hardware they were running this on?
So this was a hardware produced by Evans and Sutherland, proprietary hardware. They used vector display. They did not use raster displays for this. Yeah, so everything about it was proprietary. Okay? So there were no layouts. So just to recap, I think I'm at the end. I'll just finish a few points. You can see it's a very illustrious career throughout in education and research and applied industry work as well. So I think after Evans and Sutherland, he founded a consulting firm called Sutherland Sproul and Associates, where they advise in high technology implementations. He was a founding partner of this VC firm called Advanced Technology Ventures. I think this was in the early 80s, before it had become fashionable and glamorous. This firm still exists today. This consulting company was bought over by Sun to form Sun Labs. And Ivan Sutherland was the Sun Fellow and the VP at Sun Labs. Before, I think, so now that doesn't exist. And he's currently, at I think age of 75, he's still very active in the research and runs asynchronous research center in Portland State University. This is doing research in asynchronous circuits, like I said, I talked earlier. So if you look at it, most of his work, graphics work, was done from 1960 to 75. Since then, he has not published anything in computer graphics. So in a matter of 15 years, Ivan Sutherland has been able to achieve a huge amount of things. Later, his work has been mostly with integrated circuits. He continues to be an active researcher. His latest patent was approved last year, filed in 2008, at the age of, I think, 72, 73. So really, amazing personality. And just I would like to add, that one of the reasons he inspires awe, at least for me, is that he's a doer, and not about just graphics or things they care about, right? So I think some of them got together. Burt Sutherland is his brother, again, illustrious researcher and scientist. Together, I think sometime in the early 80s, they built this big six-legged walking machine, which they called a cockroach, just for the fun of it. I mean, there was, but you know, it was something which actually walked and worked, and I don't know whether they achieved something new in robotics there. But essentially, he was a mind who was continuously experimenting and trying out and fiddling with things, and not just content about talking about things. That's a big. So to end with, I'd just like to play a very short, 1 minute, 1.5 minute video where he talks about his learnings. This was in 2011. He was addressing some tech conference. And I think the key thing there, I think, very important for all of us to take away: do things which you like, not what the world says is trendy. Focus on one thing, do it well, and you should enjoy doing it. Otherwise, you know, it becomes a drag and a chore. So let me just play a small video, and then I think we'll get that.
Exciting period. Sketchpad is now nearly 50 years ago. And it's been 50 years of a continuous development of usability of machines for all kinds of purposes. And of course, the machines are thousands of times more powerful now than they were when we started. The important question for the future is, where do we go from here? I was amused to see that the religious wars about how to interact with a computer broke out right in this room this morning. And I've watched those religious wars over and over and over again. And my counsel is, live and let live. The right editor to use is the one you know. Okay, the right kind of bicycle to ride is the one you know. Okay, the right language to use when you speak is the one you know. And the same is true with computer interfaces. The one that you should use is the one you know. And I have no objection to a command line person who says, I like command line. They're terrific, and if you add them and you use them, two keystrokes get you a lot. And the people who love command lines just say they're the only thing to use. All of the measurements that I know of productivity using computers say that people who have good ideas about what to do are lots better at doing them independent of the tools. I will assert that Picasso would have made terrific art on computers if he'd had them. Okay, what was great about the man was not the tool he used, but what was in his head, how he was able to do it. And I think the same is true in sort of every field of human endeavor. And I urge you as you go forward to do the things that you find exciting. Doesn't matter what you do, What's important is that you find it exciting, because the things you find exciting will lead you both to your own pleasure, but also to the pleasure of others, because you're likely to do them well. And we admire things that are done well, whatever they are. A fine meal, well cooked. A fine poem, well crafted. A fine letter. It's hard to write a short, fine letter, right? But when you get one, it's really nice. A fine content.
Tony, I just thought I would share this because, you know, we face this predicament all the time, especially in this field, maturing. There are so many things happening. What is it that you should do and look at? And I really could relate to this advice, and I take it to heart, and I hope I will stick to it. So that's it. Thank you. I hope you found this useful. And if you have any questions, you can take them now. Or even later, once Sanjeev's talk is there.
Atul,
yeah.
I think the two things that are very remarkable in the 50s. You talk about the screen interaction that we show in see in the and the tablet and the virtual reality. So were there any other mention of these things earlier than him? Or you are the first who spoke about that thing? Asking about the history perspective.
Yeah. So I think there have been mentioned, like I said, right? All of this is, if you look at it, it's an incremental improvement. I think what we can definitely claim, this is the first publicly demonstrated realizable implementations of these concepts. And I'm sure there might have been something else somewhere else too, but it was not known at that point of time. Communication was probably not that easy. But I think at least the sketchpad part and the head-mounted display part, I think it's there's an unequivocal agreement between the community that they were indeed the first. People were trying to apply similar concepts differently earlier. For example, right, if you look at computer CAD model, IBM had worked with General Motors and they could actually show the entire model of a car rotating on the screen in 1958. That was before Ivan Sutherland. But it was not done through any of the systems. I mean, it was all fed in through a paper tape and it would produce pictures of this system. It was not a real-time system which you could interact with. So it is a fundamentally different creation in that respect.
And one more thing, as you spoke about the, he left the graphics after the, in the 75 somewhere. So even after doing the so remarkable and so path-breaking research in that field, is there any specific reason he moved out of that field? And
I can't claim, but I've seen a video of his where, you know, his advisor, by the way, at MIT was Claude Shannon, the creator of information theory. And in that video, he says, that video, the last video, if you look at Mom Loved Him Best, Bert and Ivan Sutherland are brothers, both are equally accomplished researchers, and this is a nice video on YouTube, 1 hour long, though. Take your time on a holiday, I mean some chippy holiday, and watch it. He says, and the advice he got from Claude Shannon was do one thing at a time and focus on it. And he says, I lost interest in graphics, integrated circuits seemed more interesting, and I just spent my time doing that. That's what he says. I don't know if there are any other reasons for this. But watch that last video, it's pretty entertaining.
Thank you.
Okay? Alright, thank you.